underway. Well, it's nice to see so many of you here. Good morning. Welcome to BCC and the Bernie W. Simpkins Business Seminar for Entrepreneurial Development. Today marks the 14th presentation in an ongoing series of introducing successful business entrepreneurs each April and November. Supplementing each seminar is a $1,000 scholarship given to a BCC student with the best entrepreneurial idea. The winner for this spring will be announced shortly. In addition, the seminar continues to foster academic curriculum devoted to entrepreneurism at BCC. I have a couple of administrative announcements I'd like to make. First of all, we ask that you please remain in your seats until our closing remarks. Secondly, please ensure your cell phones are turned off. Given your written questions to one of our ushers in the aisles is the way to ask Mrs. Davis a question. So each of you should have sheets to ask a question with, and our ushers will pick those up and bring them up to the podium. And I encourage all students to take notes for your class, and please be sure to pick up an attendance card from one of the ushers for your instructors. You know, an event like this would not be possible and requires the collective efforts of many people. I would like to acknowledge the sponsors, Florida Today and Mr. Bob Stover, managing editor. Would you stand up, Bob? Thank you. The Badcock Furniture Company for our stage props. Books a Million. Books a Million in the back for sales and signing, which is going to go on after the event today. I would also like to thank the members of the Simpkins Committee and Dr. Drake, BCC President, whose ongoing encouragement and vision is so vital to the growth of the seminar. Dr. Drake, would you please stand up and be recognized? I would also like to thank the area high schools. Are you here? Well, who are you? All right, who else? Oh, okay, but I know you're here because I got the numbers. I'd like to thank BCC faculty and staff for their support, and of course, you, the audience, for being here. Now, let's get down to business. This unique program would not be possible without its namesake, Mr. Bernie Simpkins, who is dedicated to bringing to BCC a very well-known visionaries who have built business on a hope, a dream, and a lot of hard work. Please join me in welcoming Mr. Simpkins, an outstanding entrepreneur who has made a lasting mark on our college and Brevard County. Bernie, please come forward to announce the scholarship winner.
Thank you, Dr. Fuller, and welcome, especially all of you students. We got you out of class. What better deal can you get than that? And you don't have to take a test on this, but we do want you to really absorb it. We've got a great opportunity with Mary Davis to speak to you. You also have another great opportunity to purchase one of her books that she is the author of, The Entrepreneurial Mom. And this is available to you as you exit today out this way, and they're normally $25, we reduce them down to $15, but to students, I'm going to supplement the difference. So for $5, you can have the book. It's been said that unless you've got something invested, you don't really appreciate it as much. So you've got to put $5 into the till. But be sure to think about getting one on the way out. The scholarship this time is awarded to Robin DeRusty. Robin has a 3.69 grade point average. She's absent because of personal reasons and could not be present today. but she's an outstanding student at Brevard Community College, has been a student since 2006. She's just great. She's in Dr. Fuller's class. I don't know whether there was any pull there or not. But we're real proud to award to Robin a $1,000 scholarship for her continued education. And before I sit down, let me thank especially Jim Ross, Vice President Jim Ross, department for putting this all together for us and making it available. Prevette, where are you? Prevette, here she is over here. She worked diligently. Dr. Pat Fuller, chairman of the committee, and the committee members, which have been mentioned, Bob Stover, Todd Starkey, a lot of other committee members here. Thank you for coming and thank you for being here. But especially, let me also say that Dr. Drake, you students, faculty members, and the public at large, is so fortunate to have Dr. Drake as president of this college. It's on the way up, it's growing, continuing. The entrepreneur program is all part of that, and we thank you, Dr. Drake, for permitting this to happen.
Thanks very much, Mr. Simpkins. Ladies and gentlemen, it is very much a distinct pleasure of mine at this time to introduce our president, Dr. James A. Drake.
Especially for those of you who are students, we're so pleased to have you here, whether you're in our particular courses and sections, or whether you're from Astronaut High School, and any competitors there too. Before I introduce our distinguished guest and lecturer for this 14th edition of the Simpkins Series, I do want to express a very heartfelt thanks on the part of students current as well as future to the founder of the series, Mr. Bernie Simpkins. He will forgive me for perhaps telling you something that you may have already read in the newspapers, the greatest of which is Florida Today, may I say, in case there's any doubt about that. Mr. Simpkins recently donated $1 million for this program and scholarships for this program to Brevard Community College. It completes a pledge that he had made and had begun with the initial gift that made possible the founding of this series. And because of his largesse, so many students, so many of you, so many who come after you, presidents long after myself, other staff members long after we have hopefully retired and gone on to other things, they will be the beneficiaries of Bernie Simpkins' donation to Brevard Community College and the confidence he has placed in me. You know the adage that a picture is worth 1,000 words? Well, I'll tell you what, it would take me many thousands of words to do what a film, a video that we have to show you right now will tell you about Mrs. Mary Davis, author, entrepreneur, and our lecturer and guest today. May we see the video, please.
Mary Davis is author of the inspirational and informative book, The Entrepreneurial Mom, Managing for Success in Your Home and Your Business. She is an inspiration to thousands of people who dream of developing a business of their own one day. Mary owns a successful flooring company, Interior Images Incorporated, with clients throughout Central Florida. Her inspiring and sometimes humorous book shares the ups and downs of raising children and balancing her life as a mother, wife, and as a business owner. Born in Miami, Florida, Mary moved with her family to Fort Lauderdale at an early age. She graduated from Cooper City High School and attended Broward Community College in South Florida, where she majored in journalism, then business. While attending college, Mary's love for writing inspired her to land a job at the Fort Lauderdale Sun Sentinel newspaper, where she worked in circulation and in the editorial departments. She met the love of her life, Jerry Davis, at work, and the rest is history. Mary then pursued a Florida realtor's license in 1988. A year later, she married Jerry, and the young couple moved to Brevard County, where her husband purchased a franchise, Professional Carpet Systems. The company expanded into offices throughout Florida. Jerry later started DRY Dry Force, a restorative structural drying company. While Mary worked as a licensed realtor for Trafford Realty Company, her husband lost his office manager. Mary then took over the position for only a few months, but soon longed to start her own successful company as a result. She found no books on how to start a business while raising kids, and vowed to write that book one day. After months of research, Mary founded Interior Images Incorporated, which specializes in flooring for property management companies. After starting the corporation, Mary learned that she was expecting their first child, Caitlin. 2 years later, their son, Jared, was born. On a family trip to Alaska in a crowded RV, Mary began writing the book that would help so many people, The Entrepreneurial Mom, based on her own unique experiences. She's now writing a second book called 101 Businesses for Women to Start, plus even a third book on how to write a book, get it published, and promote its sales, all without a writer's agent. Mary provides a practical roadmap to successful entrepreneurship while nurturing a wonderful family. Ladies and gentlemen, please join us in welcoming a prolific writer and a wonderful business owner. Please welcome Mary Davis, the entrepreneurial mom.
Today, I realize many of you have come here this morning in search of something. Some of you want to get your first glimpse of what entrepreneurship is really like. Some of you may even have an idea of a business that you would like to start and are searching for the next step, a little bit of information. Some of you already have a secure, stable job and are wondering if you should jump off the ledge, if you will, into entrepreneurship, into the uncertainty that may hold. I'm here to tell you that I have walked in each of your shoes along the steps. I have had the uncertainty, I have had all the questions, and I will tell you that just by being here today, you can rest assured that you do have what it takes. You're here to become educated and to learn about what you're going to do. That's one of the first steps in the process. But before we get down to that, I will tell you, I had a prepared speech for you this morning, up until Monday. And on Monday, I was in Lake Mary at the Fox 35 news station preparing to do a morning show interview. And as I stood in there, they were miking me up, and I was primping and getting ready, as we women do, concerned about how it was going to come off on camera. And I was surrounded by a bunch of TV monitors, as it was in the studio. And staring back at me from the monitors was the face of a handsome young soldier. And the reporter was delivering the very sad news that Matt Maupin had been found. His remains had been identified through DNA, and he had in fact been found in Iraq. And as she continued, the reporter gave us some facts about this soldier, and I was no longer absorbed in myself. I was listening intently, and I was listening to the parallels that she was drawing. In July 1983, this young man was born. In July 1983, I had just graduated high school in South Florida, and I was ready to take on the world, my whole life in front of me. This young man went on to grow up in Ohio. He graduated from high school with a 3.5 GPA. He played football, and he pursued an interest in writing. His interest in writing led him to receive a scholarship from the University of Cincinnati. He went to college learning about aeronautics. Sometime while he was there, he felt the desire to serve his country. He joined the Army in 2002. In 2003, his unit was deployed to Baghdad. In 2003, I was living here in Cocoa, enjoying my life, my two great kids. At the time in 2003, they were 10 and 8 years old. I was enjoying all that entrepreneurship had to offer me, the flexibility, the control. I had a good life. I did not know Matt Maupin. I do not know him today. But I went on with my life, unaware of what he was doing for me. On April 9th, 2004, we were probably in our house planning for spring break, what we would do with our kids, how I would take off and juggle my business so I could spend the week off from school with the kids. On that day, Matt Maupin's unit was attacked and his convoy was destroyed. Some of the soldiers were killed, some of them were captured, some were missing. For the next 4 years, Matt's family waited, hoped, worried, and prayed that Matt was alive somewhere in Iraq. And on Monday, they delivered the sad news to the rest of us who don't know their son, that he's not coming home. And the reason I tell you this is because as I stood there, self-absorbed in what I had going on, it dawned on me that because of Matt Maupin and others like him, I had the opportunity as a free American woman to pursue all the dreams and opportunities that life has to offer me. Because of Matt Maupin, I was in that studio that day, ready to sit down and talk about whatever I wanted, give my own opinions, and express myself freely. It really put things into perspective for me. And I wanted to share that story with you so you can remember that some of you who are thinking about entrepreneurship, while you may feel uncertain, you may feel scared, remember Matt and remember his final hours when certainly he felt uncertain and scared. And remember that he did it for us so we have the opportunity to enjoy the free enterprise system. So how can we not go out and pursue all that life has to offer us when you put it in a perspective like this? I know that Matt Maupin will forever be ingrained on my heart and in my mind. And it made a distinct impression on me. And frankly, it changed my speech for you today because I really wanted to share with you what I felt was important. So I would like to let you know that if I looked preoccupied at that time, that was why. However, if you are starting to think about your entrepreneurship ventures, you're in the right place. I may not have all the answers for you, but if I don't have the answer, I will find it for you or I'll steer you to someone who does. I hope you enjoy my talk with Dr. Drake, and I look forward to hopefully letting you go away from here with some answers and maybe a new direction. Thank you.
Well, as we take our seat here, and we'll be talking about this book, The Entrepreneurial Mom. You know, I did not realize this until I read the first 5 pages that I was reading a book which did not exist, nothing like it before this. To whom did you turn for your own inspiration to write The Entrepreneurial Mom?
To write the book, that was something that I took on myself. I've always had a love of writing, and writing is something that comes very naturally to me. And I'm a big believer in you write what you know. So the writing of the book came easily to me. The inspiration to start my own business and to run my own business, however, I got from my husband, who is an entrepreneur and has been for most of the time that I've known him, although we met at the newspaper in Fort Lauderdale. As I went through all of the ups and downs and highs and lows that an entrepreneur does have to offer, I frequently went to Jerry with my questions. Some of them were simple business or finance questions, other things. He was instrumental basically in teaching me how to deal with people. And I'm a big believer that there's two things that every business does. I don't care what your business is that you're in, there's two things: people and sales. And if you're good with people, the sales will come. And if you work your sales and go back to those people, it's a process, it's a cycle. You'll get referrals from them, you'll get repeat business. So if you are good with people, the sales will come.
Now, may we also just take a moment, because Jerry, who has been such an inspiration to you and vice versa, is with us. And in fact, we put him right here in front and center. So Jerry, would you stand up and let us just salute you.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. But then what prompted you to write the book?
Well, I'll tell you, in 1992, when I was looking to start a business, I didn't know what type of business I wanted to start. And it was at the same time that we were thinking about starting a family. And like many people, men and women, I was wondering how could I possibly do both, be a parent and run a business, because running a business does take a lot of hours, a big commitment, as does parenting. And I wanted to make sure that I could be a big part of my children's lives. I went to the bookstore literally on a rainy Saturday afternoon and I looked for a book. That was my first thought. I thought surely it's out there. And I thought someone was going to tell me how to learn to have the life balance skills to do both and balance my dual identities. Couldn't find one. There were books on business, there was books on parenting, but there was not one that melded the two things together as a hybrid, if you will. And I was very disappointed. I went away from there, I think, with 8 different books and magazines, such as Entrepreneur Magazine and things like that, looking to possibly start a franchise. I looked at many options. But none of them satiated the need that I had to find out how to do both. So I decided, being stubborn like I am, it's been pointed out to me that I should say determined, but I'm stubborn. I decided to go ahead and find a need and fill it. And I did, and I vowed that if I ever ran a successful business, that I would write a book for other people so they would not have to go through all of the perils and uncertainties that I did in trying to truly have the best of both worlds, because it's been terrific for me. Working for myself has allowed me to be there for my children and earn an income, and basically it's just offered me so much in my life.
Now, you told me, and I would love for you to tell the story in any manner that you want to, about the actual writing, the manuscript writing, the handwritten version, and how that took place. I was mesmerized, I tell you, when you told me what the circumstances were.
Well, I saved that actually because it was actually a funny time in our lives. My kids had always wanted to see Alaska, and we try to travel a good bit with our children. I just think that it really offers them so much to see other places and other people. And Alaska was a big favorite. So a few years ago, we decided we were going to take an RV trip. Now, I thought that it was going to be my husband, myself, and my 2 children. And we, fortunately, I get along great with Jerry's family. And next thing I know, his mom was going, who I love dearly. His mom was going, and her sister's husband. And so I thought, well, surely we're getting 2 RVs. I mean, that's a lot of people. And I'm not a camper. For me, if there's a power outage or something, I'm panicking. For me, camping means the night lights turned out. I just don't camp well. So the whole prospect of the RV was out of my comfort zone. So I thought all along we were getting 2 RVs. We get into Alaska, worn out and tired, and of course it never gets dark there, so your system never adapts in the time you're there on vacation. And, well, lo and behold, we have 1 RV, and 7 of us. And I thought, well, this is going to be interesting. So as we rode around Alaska in our rolling tin can, I frequently found myself feeling like I needed some space, just a little me time to get away and just have some space. And I started thinking, you know, this might be a good time for me to write down everything I know about running a business and parenting my children. So I started writing in longhand in a steno notebook that my daughter had brought to keep up with her homework, and that's how it started. And lo and behold, when we got home, I thought, I'm wondering if this is really going to go, if I can make a go of this book. So I typed it all into the computer, and what I had only turned out to be 42 typed double-spaced pages. That's not very, very much at all. But then I bought another book on how to market to publishing houses. And of course, everybody wants to be an agent because basically they get a cut of everything from the books that are sold. And I always do things the hard way. I didn't want to have an agent, so I decided to hoof it myself, if you will. And I approached maybe 30 publishing houses independently. I would first figure out what type of books they published and try to fit into their mold. And I got back a lot of those flat little envelopes. And when you open the mailbox and there's a flat little envelope from the publishing house, that's a no, that's a bad thing. So I became kind of discouraged and thought, well, maybe this is not going to work. And then several months passed and I got a phone call on my cell phone. And I'm actually glad I did not answer the phone because the message that I got was Cumberland House Publishing was calling. They loved my book idea and could they see some more of the book? And I was just in shock. I had to wait about a half an hour before I could call them back so I could put a sentence together. And so I was thrilled, and that was on a Wednesday, and the acquisitions editor asked me, when can we see the rest of the book? And I said, well, I haven't finished it. She said, well, when can we see the next part? And I said, well, I'm kind of tied up for a few days. How's Monday? I hadn't written it yet. I had stopped with those 42 pages. So I locked myself in my home office, and from Wednesday night through Sunday night, I wrote like crazy and typed it onto the computer. And fortunately, with technology today, we were able just to transmit it all back and forth on the internet. I didn't have to do any more hard copies with them. And they loved it and they bought it and it took off from there. So it was just, it was kind of interesting the way that I went at it was maybe a little unusual.
But persistent.
Yeah, persistent.
And that is a theme that will pervade, I think, everything we talk about. And also, that feeling that we all get when we take risks and the first or second or third or maybe tenth time it doesn't materialize, it's easy to fall into the pattern of feeling rejected and not being able to move. But you then became, in my view, two kinds of entrepreneur, if you will. One is you learned the publishing business the hard way and you succeeded. And it's leading to more books, may we say. But the entrepreneurial mom is, again, all but unique and beautifully written, if I may so pay you a compliment. And it's going to be something which anyone, pick any page in this book, and you're going to want to be coming back and coming back and coming back. Now, you had alluded before to the fact that this all happened at a very interesting time, at a kind of interesting conjunction in your personal life and also in your business life. This has enabled you to become your own boss, if you will. And what prompted you all along to want to be your own boss?
You know, I had not, maybe when I was high school age or college age, I had not thought about it. It hadn't dawned on me. I think most of us go to school assuming that we are going to go get an education, and then we are going to go into the workforce and get a job, and that's how we fit into society. And I find it interesting when I talk to people today, they still think that. So I love to be able to talk to students and tell them that the world is your oyster. You don't have to fit into a mold and a job and something that's already there. You can create the lifestyle for yourself. And entrepreneurship has, for me and for my family, provided us with a flexibility and a control that I would have never known working for a boss 9 to 5. I would not today be able to be at all of my children's plays at school, go on their field trips, my daughter's spelling bees, piano recitals, all these things. I would not be able to always be there because how can you tell your boss, gee, I need to take off 4 times this week? So for me, I work out of one calendar. And my Monday may have 2 customer appointments and be at my children's school at 1 o'clock for a presentation and then go off and go to the warehouse and meet some deliveries of carpet. So I'm able to schedule my life based on what the needs of our family are and still maintain a business.
Because you've been so successful so far, and to me this is just the beginning, I think we're already glad to say that we do know you, but the day is going to come when everyone in this room, and it won't be long from now, are going to say, gee, we knew her when she was right here with us at Brevard Community College in the Simpkin series. But you've taken the plunge. You've made it work. Why do you think more people don't want to or don't really persist in trying to be an entrepreneur? What holds them back?
Truly, I think that it sounds like a big, scary unknown. And I think some people have the fear of failing. Who doesn't? who wants to put your all into something and it not have it work. That's why I think the programs here are truly so important. The entrepreneurship programs offer another roadmap in addition to my book that I wrote as a roadmap for people to follow for life balance. The entrepreneurship courses can teach you everything that you need to know. You can learn at your own pace, and you will also have the benefit of coming into contact with other mentors. And I find that to be, that's one thing I like to tell everyone, get a mentor if you're going into business. Find someone, a trusted individual you can go to for everything from your questions to your inspirations. I'm fortunate enough to go to bed at night with my inspiration, so I think he's heard more than he wants to hear. We don't have the normal conversations. We have, frequently I think he's sick of talking about my business and my book, but I'm fortunate that I married my mentor. So I like to tell people, get a trusted individual who you can turn to and who wants to see you succeed too.
As we look at, one of the great themes in your book, of course, is, again, blending motherhood and entrepreneurship. Let's look at it from your children's perspective for a moment. What do you think, how do they benefit from you being an entrepreneur?
Well, it's interesting, and I've actually talked with them about this, but what's interesting is they have only known their parents as entrepreneurs. I owned my business a couple months before I became pregnant, so when Caitlin was born, she was born into a family of two entrepreneurs. We worked independently, owned separate businesses. That's what she saw. By the time Jared came along, we were well into our business, and that's all he's ever known. I would say that they benefit in several ways. Both of my kids are very independent. They're both very comfortable with themselves and with people, very comfortable in going on introducing themselves to people, carrying on conversations that I know I could have never done at their age. And I think that it's from watching us and just being around it and the environments that they're in. They of course are at our offices from time to time. That happens of course when you have kids. So they see the interaction, and it's just become natural to them. And my daughter has always said she wants to be a vet. She's never wavered from that, and I think she will. But in her mind, she's not just going to be a vet. She's going to own a veterinary practice and have other vets working for her. And I just find it interesting that in her mind, that's where she fits in, because it's what she's known.
You've talked about, too, having learned from others. What are a few of the lessons that you would underscore that you've learned over the last few years in business?
Well, as I said previously, one of the things that became crystal clear to me was that when you're in business, no matter what you do, two things are critical, sales and people. And when I was first in business, I don't want to say I was not a people person, I was not a patient people person. So I had to learn to temper that. And I think as I have developed my people skills, the sales are easier. I don't really have to work for my flooring sales, because by the time the customer calls us, they have a need. I'm able to sit in their living room as we are right now, and it's more of a people exchange that leads to that. So people and sales is something that I tell everybody, no matter what business you're in, those are the two key factors. And something else that I like to tell people is, if you go into business for yourself, you want to run a business for a reason and for it to affect your lifestyle. You don't want to be that business owner who is trying to wear all the hats and be the person who is everything from the receptionist to the warehouse manager to the salesperson to the janitor to everything. In the beginning, you will be. I myself still do. I'll hop on the forklift to unload a tractor trailer when it comes in. That's fine. But I've been everything from the janitor to the painter in the offices to the salesperson to speaking at business meetings. But at a point, you have to realize that you do not want to buy yourself a job. You don't want to be working yourself to death, covering all the bases, so you learn to delegate. And also, I think one of the big things, and an interesting thing between entrepreneurs, I think, is that we all want to be in control, which is great to an extent, but you need to learn to temper that and give up a little bit of control and delegate to other people. Allow them some latitude to make mistakes and to learn, because in the end, it's going to free you up to do what you're there to do, which is to steer your business, to manage your business. I don't want to look back and for 20 years have been doing the physical rigors of the job. I want to manage its growth and steer it. So I like to tell people to delegate and learn to let go and trust their people and their systems that they've put in place, because that's what their job is, not to micromanage. Their job is to manage the big picture.
Well, one of the biggest challenges that I think we face, especially in emerging businesses, is the phenomenon we talk about of burnout. Do you have other formulas for just preserving your sanity and keeping that balance in life? How do you do it?
Well, I had to glance at my husband. He might say I have not preserved my sanity. But from time to time, I realize I'll go, 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 and I'm the kind of person, I'll be up till 1 a.m. night after night after night catching up on things. And of course, that's a choice that we make. But then I get to a point where I literally will schedule myself an afternoon to take some time off. It may be to do nothing more than to sit and read a magazine. It may be to go get a massage or to just go to the mall and window shop. But I have to finally get to a point where I have to let go, because I think when you are an entrepreneur, it doesn't end. You're never really caught up and you never really get to the end, because it's a lifestyle. It's a journey that you're always on. So your to-do list, you've never checked everything off, because entrepreneurs are always moving. They're in motion, they're moving ahead. So also in our family, we try to schedule a couple good vacations a year with our children, because it takes us away from our businesses and our cell phones. Our best vacations are places where our cell phones don't work. So we like to spend time away with our family, and sometimes we will just go to the mountains in Virginia at this 100-year-old farmhouse where the cell phones don't work, and hike around with the kids and just kind of reconnect. And that's really important, and it's interesting, because talking to my kids, they've traveled a good bit, as I have not at their age, and so they've seen a lot more than I did at their age, and I've asked them, what are your favorite vacations? What have you liked the most? They've been all over. What they like the most is the times that we go to that 100-year-old farmhouse in Virginia when it's just our family together. So I think I find that interesting, and that's where we kind of go to recharge.
And would it be accurate to say then that it's a work hard, play hard, make time to play hard?
I put a section in my book, because we have always taught our children that, well, number one, we don't want them to take their lives for granted, and we want them to know that if you work hard, as a result, the benefit is you get to play hard. So we literally say in our house, kind of hokey, I know, we say work hard, play hard. And they know that they are able to go and enjoy terrific vacations and be exposed to things because mom and dad work hard. And we've also always waived it as a carrot for them. If they make great report cards, they get to pick the next trip. And then we plan the trip together and everything. So for them, they've worked hard, they get to play hard. And I think, I'm hoping it's a life lesson that when they get older, that they will realize the value of hard work and the payoff in the end.
Winning formula. You know, in the book, and again, I go back to what I was saying before, I think of you as an entrepreneur, not only in publishing, because of how this book and your subsequent ones have come about, but then you have a main business as well. And I'd like to talk with you about that. What are some of the products and services that you offer in your main business?
All kinds of flooring, carpet, tile, vinyl, laminate, hardwood flooring. We also offer interior decorating, which has just come about in the last few years. Frankly, when I was first in business, I needed to go into business and do something that would make me money fast, fewer jobs, larger income, larger profits. So I went into the flooring business because those were large ticket items. Now I'm able to also do the fun stuff, which is the interior decorating, and we do, you may have seen in the video, some hand-painted murals, faux finishing, that type of stuff. And for me, you're asking how I recharge. For me, I love to paint, and so for me, doing the murals is something that I actually enjoy. So for me, that's not a day of work. That's just a day of relaxation. So basically, we offer full interiors, but our main focus and our biggest ticket items, of course, is the flooring.
Now, the flooring business, and I'm not sure how I can ask you this, so I'll just try to do it straightforwardly. It's traditionally been a man's world. Now, as a woman who was just getting into that field and then trying to build her own business, is there any way you can describe what that may have been like?
In mixed company and not, and be politically correct, I'm not sure. It was really very tough. I did choose an industry that is not typically something that women go into. I did look at the typical bridal shops and day spas and little boutiques and that sort of thing, and I would have absolutely loved that, but I didn't know if I would get the return on that. So I basically found a need and filled it. When I first started my flooring business, people that knew me thought I was crazy because, I hate to say this and admit this now, but I did not know anything about flooring. I did not know how to measure flooring. I did not know how carpet was manufactured or the history of carpet. So I jumped in, but this is how I do everything. I jump in and learn as I go. So it was really difficult. And the installers can be some tough-talking guys, let me tell you. And then here's little Mary Davis, who my first year in business, I was pregnant for most of it. So here's a female pregnant telling these tough-talking carpet guys what to do. It was really, really tough. I honestly would not wish that total scenario on anyone. If I could have had my druthers, I would not have gone through it pregnant, but that was the way that it turned up. So I was already too far in my business to stop. So I kept going. And right up through the delivery of our first child, our daughter, my labor was induced. So I was in the hospital, knew when I was going in there. And the doctors, because at the time I did not have a lot of help, I would actually place the orders at the carpet mill and I was hands-on. So I had to place the orders that day. So I was literally on the phone placing orders with the carpet mill while they were starting my IV drip to induce me. And the doctor said, "Do you think you can give us an hour?" And I said, "Yeah, I'll be done in just a minute here. You don't understand. I can't tell these people that the carpet's not gonna make it and I've gotta get this in." And he looked at me like he'd never seen anything like this before. So it was very unconventional. And the one bad thing was I was not able to take maternity leave, so to speak, because I had to keep working because it was in the early years of my business. So I had to keep physically being out there, seeing my customers and everything. And I tried to do that with my daughter. I thought somehow that I would be able to take this infant to my office and work with her. And that did not last long. I thought that I would be able to have her there with me and be answering the phone and unloading the semis on forklift and everything. After only a week, I decided, okay, she would not come second to anything, and we were going to have in-home childcare. So we were able to get in-home childcare. And I, fortunately, again, because of my schedule, I was able to go to work and come and go throughout the day. So I was able to, you know, I would know that she would nap from 12 to 2 and that she'd be up at 2. So I could, you know, I could come home at that time. If my day was over, that was great. The sitter could leave. If not, you know, I could still be in and out of her life, which a job would not have allowed me.
Well, how long was the time between when you thought about starting your business and when you actually did?
I guess about a year. I really thought about it because when I was working in my husband's office, I really enjoyed watching him run the big picture. He's very good at not micromanaging. That was something I had to learn. And I really enjoyed learning from him and seeing him growing his business, basically. It was energizing. There was literally an electric energy around, and I thought, gee, I really like this. And so maybe 6 months into watching that is when I started thinking, you know, maybe I can do this. And I went through the self-doubt of, do I have what it takes? You know, gee, I'm not the same person. I don't have the same background. I'm a woman. I hate to admit that at the time. Now I know it does not matter. I guess it was about a year, the investigation process, before I finally decided what I would do, and I jumped in.
And you mentioned some of the other business opportunities you were looking at. And that included day spas and such, the more traditional, quote-unquote, and bridal shops and such. But how did you sort of say no to some of those opportunities and then finally decide on this one? And what did your research show you then?
I had a friend who was a property manager. She managed hundreds of rental apartment units. And she said that one of their biggest frustrations was they could not get a decent carpet company that was reliable and dependable and could provide a decent service at a decent price. And I thought, well, gee, I can do that. So I did some research, and it was a little bit nerve-wracking at times because I had a lot of self-doubt what I was going into. I would have been more well-suited for the day spa boutique type thing. But when I realized there's a need for this, and where there is a need, I mean, there's an opportunity, and if I work hard, I can certainly do it. So I basically just jumped in at that time. The timing was right also, because there wasn't even LeVar County, and word spread quickly because I was very hands-on in the business, and they saw my face. They knew I was back checking the jobs after they were installed. They knew I had control over the installers, and it built a confidence, and I was able to spin off referrals because of that. I worked a lot of hours. I will tell you, I won't lie to anybody thinking about it. It's a lot of hours at first, but the payoff is worth it later.
Now, in your particular business, and in fact with most businesses that offer products at least, you know, there are two ingredients you have to consider for starting the business. One is financing, and the other are suppliers.
Mm-hmm.
If we might talk about suppliers first, how much of a challenge was that, and how did you get your suppliers on your side?
That was a big challenge, and I was very naive to that process. I thought, gee, if I call the carpet mills and tell them I want to buy, they're going to be at my door. No. What it is you need to, first of all, of course, you have to prove to them that you are a viable business. You have to have a location, of course. And then they have reps that are in the area from the various carpet mills. Those reps protect their larger dealers, of whom I was not one, of course. Some of them basically told me, you know, no, we're not going to sell to you because I sell to the big boys down the street. Finally, I hooked up with one guy from the largest carpet mill from Shaw Industries, and his name was Steve Jeslow, and he was kind enough to not only take me on as a new vendor, but literally, at the time I didn't have an office when I was thinking about doing it, literally came to my home and went over things with me, and then later came to my office and helped me get set up. Had it not been for one person taking an interest, I don't know that I would have been able to break through. The interesting thing is, once other mills saw that he was getting sales from me and that I was going to be a contender, they were coming back trying to then get my business. And I have to tell you, it was probably 5 to 7 years into my business when a very rewarding moment came when one of the reps had been very, frankly, ugly to me and telling me he wasn't going to sell to me. And he came back trying to get my business. And I said, "You don't remember me, do you?" And he said, "No, have we met?" And I said, "Yeah, you told me that you were not going to sell to me before because you were protecting, you know, other people and protecting their sales." And he said, "Oh, well, that's in the past." And I said, "I don't forget the past." So I said, "Sorry." So, and later on, he came back again. I said, "Sorry." So I learned a valuable lesson from the other side then, too, that business relationships are so critical. The things that you do and say and the people that you meet, you never know later when that person is going to come back into your life. So it's so important to maintain a positive ebb and flow with everybody.
Also, as we talk about the financing part of it now, had you really dealt with banks and other financial institutions, other than just as, you know?
I had, in my husband's business, I had dealt somewhat with it. I did not have a financial background, and frankly, that scared me. In my case, I was able to take our savings to start a business, take some of our savings, but I was real careful. I did not want to go into debt. It scared me personally to go into debt and go take on a large loan. I could have gotten a personal loan, could have gotten a new business loan. I didn't do it in my case. Things might have been easier had I done that, but my goal was to start generating sales and to work from those revenues. That was going to be my plan. I always knew that was my plan, and I worked toward it. But there's a lot of programs out there for people today through the SBA and such. There's a lot of different loans and grants that are available to new businesses today.
Now, you've got you've really got two offices. You've got a nice office in your home, and we saw footage from that. And then, of course, you have your office, if you will. But pick whichever one you want. I think even the home office would be nice. What's a typical, quote-unquote, office day like for you now?
You know, the thing I like about my life is that there's not a typical day. I like the fact that my days are unplanned. I have a schedule that I keep, and I may know, like I know on Friday that I'll be in Orlando for an appointment at 1:30. And of course today and tomorrow I'll be doing the BCC stuff, but I also have customers. I'll schedule my customers. Usually I'll take my kids to school in the morning at 7:30, come back, get ready for my work day. Sometimes I don't have to go to the office if I'm leaving to go. Most of my sales are done in my customers' living rooms, which works out great because they don't have to leave the comfort of their homes. They're able to see the colors and the styles of the flooring in the environment where they're going to be, which is a big plus. We don't charge for estimates, and as a result, we close over 90% of our customers because it's such an easy give and take. So I'll go see my customers maybe in the morning. I'll know that I've got deliveries coming, and I'll go myself to the warehouse and meet the deliveries. I'll go to the post office, do my banking and such. Frequently, my kids will have something at school. My son right now is participating in a play, so he's got that at school. I'll go by there and pick him up and maybe take him to basketball practice, go home and do paperwork at night. So my day is not like 9 to 5 when you would go and you work at your office from 9 to 5, and then you would change channels and you'd be mom for the rest of the night. I touch on all the points throughout the day of both identities. And I really like that. I like the fact that I don't know what's coming next. I like that.
Well, after 17 years as an entrepreneur now, what are some keys to success that you can give us?
You know, take every opportunity for education that there is, especially at this college. There's a lot of things which at the time I did not know about. Take every opportunity to learn. I find that the most successful entrepreneurs are people who continue to learn. They don't think they know it all. They're very humble. They want to always better themselves and find out more about other people. They don't think that they know everything that there is out there. And I have personally found and know that the most successful entrepreneurs that I know have some of the same key things. They live their life from a faith-based standpoint, which I find very interesting. They're continually learning and they're very humble, and they give back. They take every opportunity to give back because they are grateful for where they've gotten, even though they've worked like crazy to get there. So basically, educate yourself, don't be afraid to give back, and just keep going. Have the determination to know that you're going to succeed. Like Matt Maupin, the soldier that I spoke about, the uncertainty and the fear that Matt must have known is nothing compared to what we're thinking about right now. And because of him, we're all able to sit here today and talk freely about what we're going to do with the rest of our lives. And we live in the greatest country on the planet, so how can we not take advantage of the opportunities? You only live once. You take the chance. See what entrepreneurship can do for you.
Thank you so much. Please join us for a round of applause.
We do have time for a couple of questions. I know I've seen a couple of you writing feverishly. If you would hand those questions to our ushers, we'll get them up here to Ms. Davis. And while we're doing that, let me just say, if you are sitting in a seat with a red dot on the back of your program next to Mr. Simpkins' picture, we owe you a free book. So those of you with red dots on your program, if you will present those to the book signing table in the back, you can pick up a free book. Also, Mrs. Davis will be hosting a book signing and sales when we finish here in just a couple of moments. And we also have some refreshments for you down the hallway at the rear of the room. At 2 p.m. this afternoon, there's going to be a special free planetarium show. If your time permits, we encourage you to stick around and see the planetarium show through these doors right upstairs. If you've never been here before, I guarantee you it will be a joyous occasion.
Just for a moment, Pat, while the questions are being gathered and passed up, as soon as Dr. Fuller completes his remarks, we can just ask you, if you feel up to it, stand up, ask a question, and I'll be happy to repeat it if need be, and we'll make sure that we take full advantage of every minute we get with Mrs. Davis.
Very good. Very good. I do want to make one, actually two final announcements. One is, of course, that in Melbourne tomorrow, we're going to do this again. And after that, we have a special roundtable by the Small Business Development Center, which is one of our entrepreneurial arms of the college. Mrs. Peek, will you stand up and be recognized, please? And Vicki is going to be conducting a roundtable at the Melbourne campus. So if you have an opportunity to be in that, it is open to the public. And the last announcement that I have, we have some questions coming up? The last announcement that I have is our speaker for this coming fall, who is Deborah Fields, Mrs. Fields Cookies, in November. So mark your calendars. I turn it back to Dr. Drake, and I want to thank you for being here with us. We'll see you at the table in the back.
Okay, we have some questions here. This one is from Terry Kim McNeil. Terry, thank you. Let me just read it to you, Mary. 2 years ago, I decided to own my own business. I'm struggling and feel like I do not know what to do next. The business is a real estate industry-related business, and with the market and my lack of marketing know-how, I'm not sure when to know it's time to call it quits and just go get a regular job. I'm currently enrolled in business classes to continue my education, but I can't help but wonder if it's too late.
You know, it's never too late, but you're right, it's a bad time with the real estate market the way that it is. One of my first questions to you would be, do you have a business plan? Do you have a mission statement for your company and what you're doing? Some people just go and open their doors and think it will come. You need to have a plan and work your plan. A plan to find your customers, market to your customers, and know where you're going to go with the next step. I wouldn't say that it's too late. I don't know if it's true. I'm hearing from people that the real estate market will be turning around here, which we all are hoping for. But the first thing I would say is to get yourself organized and have a business plan. It doesn't have to be anything formal unless you're going for financing, which you're probably not at this point. But you need to make a plan for how you're going to market yourself and what you're going to do each step of the way, and make a timeline and follow your plan. That always seems to put things into perspective for me.
Another question, this from a BCC COCO student. I would like to know when you plan to publish your book on how to publish your own book without an agent.
When I have time to finish writing it. That writing is actually what I really love to do and another way that I like to relax. So that idea actually came to me when I went to the bookstore looking for a book that would tell me how to do my own publicity, because I found that although I have a publicist at the publishing house, she handles a dozen books. I'm only worried about my book. So I started doing publicity for myself, and it has really paid off. So again, I've learned by jumping in, getting my feet wet, and I couldn't find a book on specifically an author who had done that. So I decided, gee, guess what? From what I'm learning, I'm going to write that. I would say probably within a year. I would love to say it'll be done by the end of this year, but I want it to be full of all the details. And I'm still learning the publicity end. So hopefully what I learn, someone else can benefit from.
Well, for now, The Entrepreneurial Mom is the book you want to have, the book you want to read. And I tell you what, we've got a unique opportunity here to have an author signed copy here, not only for those of you who have the free books, but also, as Mr. Simpkins said, for a minimum $5 investment and the privilege of getting a chance to spend some more personal time back here at the signing table with Mary Davis. We hope you take advantage of that. If not now, then tomorrow in Melbourne. And for now, we want to thank you for being here and ask you to join us in congratulating, thanking, and still encouraging for a great future
Mary E. Davis. We'll see as many of you as we can in the back of the room here at the signing table. Have a good day, and thanks again for being part of the Simpkins Entrepreneurship Series.
Acupuncturist, messenger notes. know, your speech today actually gave me more or less a wonderful amount of anxiety.
Yeah, what she's probably went through, raising the ranks.
Also, there was no information on the subject, which you started.
Right, exactly. That's exactly what I'm talking about. Who do you want this one to?
It's my own
Really? Yeah,
he enjoys it. What's your name?
Shao Hu,
Thank you for coming.
This is my first semester here. It's my first class with them.
I just got to the gym. I took orders tomorrow. R.I.E. for the next year. And Serena is a big R. Thanks for coming today.
Hi.
Yeah. You want to
check in?
Yeah.
That's a lot of hours.
Yeah, that's a lot of hours.
Around here?
Yes.